Next up for us is cells. Now, one of the things I've been saying, it's a little bit hard to wrap your brain around AP1 when you're just talking about anatomical terms and you're talking about chemistry and things like that. It's still a little bit difficult with cells, but at least we're getting a little closer to where you're going in life, which is you're going to treat people with disease or you want to understand your own health in regards to disease. So we can do that a little bit with cells because we can relate things like genetic mutations or mitochondria may fail and that can lead to fatigue, or there's certain diseases of like lysosomes, little cellular subunits, for example, Tay-Sachs disease. So at least it gets to be a little bit real now. So our main topics here are what are cells, gonna spend a little bit of time on what cells are, different types of cells, give you an idea of something called cell theory. Gonna talk about parts of cells, that's obviously gonna take up quite a bit of time. Then we'll do cell cycle, so how does a cell divide? And it divides a little bit differently if it's trying to make a sperm or an egg, or if it's just trying to make a brand new cell that looks exactly like its mother cell, which is called a daughter cell. We're also going to talk about the central dogma. The central dogma is how you take DNA and turn that into a product of protein. So the DNA sometimes needs to replicate itself, but oftentimes it needs to turn itself into something called RNA and then into protein. So essentially, the central dogma is how biological information gets turned into proteins. If we expand out, just to give you an idea of where we're going, so we got to talk about different parts of the cell. That's going to take a lot of time because we got to talk about the plasma membrane, the nucleus, the endomembrane system. If we bump this up a little bit, is the nuclear envelope, ribosomes, rough ER, smooth ER, Golgi apparatus. We got to talk about other things in the cells called cytoplasmic organelles, which are lysosomes, peroxisomes, and mitochondria. Then we're back over here to cell cycle, where we're going to do mitosis and meiosis. Obviously not a lot with meiosis, but mitosis, we'll come back to things like cancer, because cancer is essentially when a cell is dividing when it shouldn't be. And mitosis is cell division, so mitosis gives us an idea or an understanding about cancer. And then, like I said, we're back to the central dogma, which is DNA needs to replicate itself if a cell needs to divide. But DNA also serves the purpose of being the template to make proteins. That process of making proteins is broken down into two steps. Transcription, where you copy the DNA into something called mRNA. The way I think about this is when you make blueprints for a building, you don't just make that one blueprint and take it out to the job site. You got to make a copy of it first. So in the case of cells, you don't just let your DNA, your main blueprint, go out into the cytosol and make protein. You make a copy of it first. So making a copy of it is transcription. Translation is when you take that transcription or that copy and you turn it into your product. So that's translation. All right, so those are our main topics in covering cells. So again, cells, the living units, kind of a cool picture. I should mention when I see this figure is a lot of the figures that are used in this Prezi are Creative Commons, and they're pulled from either Wikipedia or OpenStax. OpenStax is a really nice source, a free online textbook that's been funded by sources like the Gates Foundation. So you can get yourself a free AMP textbook, and you can get it in PDF form if you like to read it on an iPad or any kind of form. It would be nice if you could send them a donation because what they're doing is really pretty cool. So that's OpenStax, OpenStax, OpenStax. All right, so what are cells? Kind of like I previewed at the beginning, you should start to think about cells in terms of disease. So it's going to get a little bit easier when we get into other topics, but you can start doing that now. So think of some major diseases and see if you can reason out how those affect cells. So like sickle cell anemia pops into my head, where a blood cell will turn into a sickle shape and that will block capillaries. So blood won't be able to get through and you won't be able to deliver oxygen. Tay-Sachs disease or Alzheimer's, it's usually a product builds up in neurons, so the neuron can't function very well anymore. A little under 1 in 3 of us is going to have heart issues at some time. That's going to be not enough blood to the cells, or if not enough blood makes it to the cells, then the cells will die. So with cells, we're finally getting into areas where we can start to relate the AMP to pathology and disease, or at least do it a little bit more easily. The first thing to note is, what is cell theory? Now, depending on who writes it, it can be kind of complex. So I would always say, try and take the cell theory, whatever textbook writer has written it, and try and put it in your own words. So that's what I've done here in the next slide. Cells are basically the building blocks of life. So they're the smallest unit of life. Each cell has its own function, so a neuron has its own function, but it has to work together within a bigger picture in order for the organism to work. A cell is the sum of the parts, and it has lots of parts. So you have to be able to think about all the different parts. If a cell doesn't have a mitochondria, or the mitochondria is not working well, then the cell's not going to work well. And then to go and expand on the number 2 from that one, if a mitochondria is not working in the whole body and not making as much ATP, then the first system that might be affected would be the nervous system. So in diseases like Lay's disease, where mitochondria are not quite as efficient, it's usually going to manifest itself in systems that use a lot of ATP, like neurons. And last one, 4, all cells come from other cells. So if you're a cell, you had a mom and a dad cell. Cells don't arise from nothing. I think it's important to simplify even more. Break it down into the key words so that you can memorize cell theory. So cells are building blocks. Each cell has a job of its own. Cell is the sum of its parts, and all cells come from other cells, so that you can reproduce cell theory. One of the things I'm going to emphasize in this chapter is making really good note cards. So not necessarily one word note cards, but maybe 5x6 note cards or 6x4 note cards, a little bit bigger of a note card that you can get everything that you need on that one big note card. And then we're going to have maybe 15 of these. And if you can get these 15 note cards committed to memory, you basically have all of cells, the chapter on cells, memorized. So you might want to make a card on cell theory. Before we move on, though, let's just appreciate that when we talk about cells, we kind of have a general cell. But cells can be all kinds of different shapes. So skin cells and neurons and pigment cells like a melanocyte are awfully different. Or even muscle cells are different depending on where it is. Is it skeletal? Is it cardiac? Is it smooth? Lung cells are different than thyroid cells and pancreatic cells. So here again are some cool images from OpenStax and Wikipedia. So these are epithelial cells. So this might be a sheet of squamous cells or squamous cells if you want to pronounce it that way that make up skin. Cool red blood cells. The one off to the right looks like a T helper cell. Neuronal cells are pretty cool. They need to communicate with a lot of other cells, so they need to branch out quite a bit. Macrophages need to extend arms, kind of like lassos, and they'll lasso bacteria and debris and suck it back into the cell. So just showing that there's a huge variety of cell shapes. That being said, we're usually going to use a generalized cell structure, because all cells are going to have these parts. The basic functional unit of a living organism is the, of course, cell. Now, when we start talking about cells, it's sometimes good to use the metaphor of a factory, because a factory has things like a security or a walls. It has to be able to communicate with the outside, needs power, needs blueprints, needs spare parts, internal transportation to move the car. If you're thinking about Henry Ford, moving the car down the assembly line. Assembly line, quality control, you got to be able to ship things out, so there's got to be an export system. And the cell, the security and walls, is the plasma membrane. Or the cell membrane. Communication are membrane receptors. Power supply is generally ATP. Blueprints are DNA, which are those are your special blueprints that stay back in the nucleus. But sometimes you need to make a copy of those blueprints to make protein, and that's RNA. Spare parts are going to be amino acids, lipids, nucleotides, and sugars. Transportation is microtubules. Quality control and assembly is ER, endoplasmic reticulum, and Golgi. And then you ship things out through vesicles in a process called exocytosis. So that's the what are cells. Let's see where we got to go next. We got to go to parts of cells, but that's going to be kind of broad. So we got parts of cells, but we got the plasma membrane and a lot of things that go into the plasma membrane. We got the nucleus, the endomembrane system, which is a system to make proteins. And then you got other organelles like lysosomes and peroxisomes and mitochondria. So let's start with parts of cells. Then we'll do again plasma membrane, nucleus, endomembrane system, and cytoplasmic organelles. Plasma membrane. Okay, so just like we use a model of the cell, we have a model of the plasma membrane, which just kind of oversimplifies things, but it's a good place to get started. The first thing you might notice is all these little things down here, which are called phospholipids. We talked about this when we talked about chemistry and we talked about lipids. One of the type of lipids is a phospholipid. So it's got a polar head and a nonpolar tail, and it arranges itself in a phospholipid bilayer. You'll notice, and we'll talk about this later, these glycolipids, glyco means sugar. These are sugar tags so that the outside of a cell can kind of announce, hey, I'm this type of cell, or it's used in cell signaling. We got all kinds of proteins, some that kind of wind through, some that make a tunnel, some that kind of just stick in there, some that will bind on the outside and transmit a message to the inside. Another thing to maybe point out is cholesterol. All of this is pointed out to just mention that the plasma membrane is often called the fluid mosaic model. I'm going to show you an image real quick that shows you why it's fluid. It's very, very movable, but also it's called a mosaic, as in there's lots of different stuff in there. So there's a lot of different things in a mosaic. The model describing the structure of the cell membrane is known as the fluid mosaic model. So D. There's a lot going on in the plasma membrane, and we're going to break each of these down soon, but it forms a barrier. I'm a very visual person, so I want a picture to associate each of these functions. Usually I can remember these functions really well if I think about a nice long barrier like the Great Wall of China. Control exit and entry, kind of a funny picture, but it's showing a doggy door on the side of a car. Also, that car is in Breaking Bad. That's an Aztec, so that's kind of cool. But anyway, it controls exit and entry. It's kind of a funny picture that helps me remember that cells need to let things in and out. Cell membranes maintain a voltage. That's going to be really important when we start to talk about neurons and how the heart controls heart rate and contractility. Cell-to-cell communication, kind of just a general idea of how you have cell-to-cell communication, is cups on a string, kind of one of those play telephones. And then support, like the girders of a building. You need girders inside of your cell, and that's created by the cytoskeleton. So again, here we're back to note cards, and the way I would make this note card is a real basic image up on the top with structure. So remember those phospholipid bilayers? Remember, phospholipids have two sides. They have a polar head that likes water and a nonpolar tail that likes fats. If you arrange yourself this way, water will stay on the outside, and it's going to be hard for water to pass through that bilayer. Another thing about plasma membranes, it's thin. It's a mosaic because there's lots of stuff in there, and then it's fluid. The five major functions of the plasma membrane is it's a barrier, and that's going to lead us into a discussion of diffusion. Controls exit and entry, that's going to lead us into a discussion of something called transport. Maintains a voltage, so it maintains a membrane voltage, and we'll have a card on that. Cell-cell communication, so we'll have a card on membrane receptors. And also their support, so we'll have a card on cytoskeleton. So let's dive into those topics. Again, we see up here we've got the structure of the membrane, basic properties, and then the five major functions are broken down out here. So structure of the plasma membrane. So we saw the structure earlier in chemistry. So again, this is a phospholipid. The head is called hydrophilic. It's got these charges, and so it likes water. It likes to interact with the partial charges of water. This side is the hydrophobic tail, does not like water. So you've got a molecule on one side that likes water, and on the other side does not like water. Or on one side likes fats, but on the other side does not like fats. They arrange themselves in a lipid bilayer, so that the polar heads are out and the nonpolar tails are towards the inside. This creates a pretty nice barrier because water molecules don't really want to go through very well. They can, but they don't want to go through very well because they don't want to go through that nonpolar area. And then nonpolar things also struggle to get through the polar area. Small lipids can make it through, but it's a little bit hard for small lipids to even make it through because there's an area that doesn't like lipids. Phospholipids orient themselves in aqueous solution such that, well, I don't like A because the polar heads are not pointed inward. I don't like B. I kind of like D. The polar heads face the interior and exterior of the cell, while the tails form the center of the membrane. So I like D. Because of the lipid content, the interior of the membrane is hydrophobic. Doesn't like water. The component of the cell membrane primarily responsible for its functionality is the proteins allow the membrane to do different things. So different receptors and different channels and things like that. So that allows the membrane to do different things. So the membrane in a neuron would have different proteins than the membrane of, say, a fat cell. The cell membrane is composed mostly of phospholipids and proteins. So I like C, phospholipids and proteins. So that's the structure of the plasma membrane. Let's talk about basic properties. So what I have here is an image, or a small movie rather, that shows just how fluid the plasma membrane is.
To demonstrate the fluidity of the lipid bilayer, a piece of the plasma membrane of this neuronal cell is pulled out with laser tweezers. Remarkably, moving this membrane tubule rapidly back and forth does not rupture the plasma membrane, which flows quickly to adapt to the mechanical distortion.
So I think that movie just shows just how easily the plasma membrane is allowed to adapt and move and how fluid it is. The plasma membrane, it's also a gatekeeper, so that's something that's important to remember. It keeps things out, so that lipid bilayer doesn't really let molecules through, but they will diffuse through if they're really, really slow. This is a process called diffusion, which we'll talk about in a second. But that's the basic properties of the membrane. So now we got to do the five major functions of membranes. We'll go through these on the note cards. If we look at this note card a little bit closer, we'll see that the main things we're going to talk about for the barrier is diffusion and osmosis. So osmosis and diffusion. So we have to define those first. Diffusion is basically that things like to spread apart. So if you put a dye in a glass of water, it'll spread apart. Or if you put salt water in a glass of water, the salt likes to spread apart. It happens in people too, so you'll spread around a classroom. Diffusion is pretty important in biology because sodium and things like that will diffuse and then water will go with it. Another example is in CF. CF, the protein, is called the cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator. You don't need to know that, but it moves chloride. And then when chloride moves, water will follow it. Essentially, chloride moves, sodium follows, and then water follows. Cholera toxin. What happens in cholera toxin is a form of food poisoning, I guess, or a poisoning in the gut. And so chloride will be dumped into the gut, and water will follow it. Cell swelling and shrinking, these are all issues related to diffusion. We should clarify first that facilitated diffusion is when there's a tunnel. So for example, when you eat food, there's a whole bunch of glucose in your stomach, and that is allowed to diffuse into the blood through a tunnel. So that's facilitated diffusion. It's still going down its concentration gradient, so it's moving from high concentration to low concentration. It's just helped by a tunnel. That's facilitated diffusion. Now, the key thing about diffusion is if things can't diffuse, so say they can't pass through the cell membrane, then they'll still try and draw water. The way I think about this is things like to spread apart, but if they can't spread apart, they'll try and draw water to at least make the cell that they're in bigger, so then they're able to spread apart. So technically, osmosis is water likes to move towards concentration, or even a little bit more simply, water likes to move towards stuff. So if we put red blood cells in a hypertonic solution, this means a solution that's highly concentrated. Water will move towards stuff by leaving the cell. So water will move towards the high concentration by leaving the cell. Isotonic means the concentration inside the cell is the same as the concentration outside. So water will move in and out of the cell at an equal rate. If you put a red blood cell in a hypotonic solution, hypo means below, like a hypodermic needle goes below the skin. Well, then what's going to happen is, again, water is going to go towards stuff or towards concentration, but now there's a higher concentration inside the cell, so the water will move inside the cell. We use the term tonicity down here to describe how concentrated solutions are. This one, again, is from OpenStax, kind of a little bit nicer, a little bit more clear. Hypertonic solution refers to the concentration of the solution outside of the cell. So hyper, again, a hyperactive kid is an overly active kid. A hypertonic solution is an overly concentrated solution. Water moves towards concentration, so water will leave the cell, move towards the hypertonic concentration, and the cell will shrink. An isotonic solution, the concentration is the same inside and outside, so water will move inside and out of the cell at an equal rate, so there's no osmotic flow. If you put the cell in a hypotonic solution, hypo means below, so a hypodermic needle is below, that means water is going to move towards the higher concentration. So we've made the concentration outside of the cell lower. That means the inside of the cell is more concentrated. Water will move towards that concentration, will move inside the cell, and the cell will swell. Back to that kind of just showing those cartoons of red blood cells. In an isotonic solution, the cells stay the same. Hypotonic solution, the cells will swell. In a hypertonic solution, the cells will shrink or crenate. If you wanted to look at actual images, so these cells are shrinking. These cells are normal red blood cells. And these are cells that have swelled because water moved towards stuff or moved towards the higher concentration inside the cell. Osmosis and diffusion is going to come up over and over in AMP. And when you're dealing with health later on in life, electrolytes and osmosis is going to be kind of a big deal. So I think this is kind of a nice note card that summarizes the major things. Diffusion is things want to move apart. Osmosis is when these things can't move out of the cell, they can draw water. And when they draw water, it does help them move apart, but it also is going to make this cell swell. So when things move, that's diffusion. When water moves, that's osmosis. Now you can do some additional things here if you want some additional understanding, like the rate of diffusion is proportional to how much area there is to diffuse, plus the gradient, how much of a difference in concentration there is, divided by the resistance, so is there a difficulty diffusing, and then the thickness of a membrane. Furthermore, you can talk about rates of diffusion as the surface area allowed, so the small intestine increases surface area by having these little fingers called villi and microvilli that increases diffusion. Concentration gradient, so a higher concentration gradient will improve diffusion. if there's channels to reduce the resistance, that will increase diffusion. Or if in the case of oxygen diffusion in the lung, you have a very thin membrane, so it's easy for oxygen to diffuse out of the air sacs and into blood vessels. So those are the things that affect diffusion and osmosis. And again, might as well make a note card to explain isotonic, hypertonic, and hypertonic. What I'm showing down here is you should be able to make some basic predictions. So if a cell is in solution Y, what would happen if we doubled the concentration of Y? Well, it kind of depends on if the cell is shrinking or swelling to begin with. So if the cell is in solution Y and it's shrinking, that means water is leaving the cell. So that means Y is more concentrated than X. So if we doubled Y, the water would move sooner. Or if the cell is swelling, then we know that the concentration outside the cell is less than the concentration inside the cell. So if we doubled Y, we might not exactly know what happens because we may not have actually got the concentration the same. But if we know if we reduced Y, well, the problem was is Y was already less than X. And so we know that the cell is going to swell even faster. If the cell is staying the same, then of course, if we double X, then we know that that's going to increase the concentration inside the cell, so the cell will start to swell. Or if the cell is staying the same, but we double Y, well, we know that now we're going to make the concentration more concentrated outside the cell, and so water is going to leave the cell. Water is going to go towards concentration, and the cell is going to swell. So that's a little bit more advanced thinking. But again, osmosis and diffusion are going to be important concepts, so you really want to be able to wrap your brain around those. A red blood cell placed into a container of distilled water will, so that's going to be a hypotonic solution, water is going to move into the cell. And since it's the movement of water, we're talking about osmosis. The cell is going to gain water by osmosis, so I like B. Which of the following is not an example of simple diffusion? Gas exchange is simple diffusion. Dissolving a sugar cube is. Popcorn, so the smell permeating your room, that's diffusion. A white blood cell engulfing a bacterium, that's not diffusion. A white blood cell is actually moving towards the bacterium. So that's all the things that go into forming a barrier. So you might ask, there's got to be a lot more going on here, DJ, than diffusion and osmosis. And of course there is. There's a whole lot more going on. But we're going to break it down into parts. So the next thing we're going to do is control exit and entry. So how do things get in and out of the cell? You got to get glucose into the cell. You got to get waste products out of the cell. Before we go to the individual cells, though, we should talk about how cells can group together or clump together to form a barrier as well. So where two cells come together or multiple cells come together and they kind of weld themselves to each other so something can't get through, it's called a tight junction. That word I used was weld. So what holds the cells together is a desmosome. Desmosomes will hold one cell next to another. Now, sometimes you need communication across the cells that are stuck together, and so that's a gap junction. It's a hole between the cells, but I think we have some better images coming up here. So again, when we've got multiple cells stuck together, so this is one cell over here and another cell over here, they're stuck together in what's called a tight junction. So let's try and take a little bit closer look at this. And I think the key figure is down here is what they're trying to show. And it's a little bit blurry because the image is not that big. But we've got multiple cells. Or we got a cell right here. And it's trying to be joined to another cell over here and another one over here. This area where the cells are joined together is called a tight junction. So this area where the cells are kind of welded together by a desmosome is a tight junction. Now, another thing that's also kind of hard to see is you might want this cell to still be able to communicate with this cell. So you might want a tunnel between these cells. That tunnel between the cells is called a gap junction. The proteins that make up that gap junction are connexins, but really you can see here it's just a tunnel. So whatever's happening in this cell is balanced with whatever is happening in this cell. This is kind of a closer look at that. So again, let's go down here and we'll talk about these are cells that are joined together. They're joined together by desmosomes. The overall structure is called a tight junction. And we can draw this pretty simply in a card. These are different epithelial cells. The overall structure is called a tight junction. These cells are joined together by desmosomes. So those are kind of like rivets or welds. But these cells still want to let things pass back and forth. And it's gap junctions that allow things to pass back and forth between cells. Now let's go to individual cells. So an individual cell might want to be able to move things in and out of the cell. The three main types of transport are passive, active, and bulk flow. Passive means things are going to move on their own. There might be a tunnel or something to help it, but there's not going to be any energy. So this is going to rely on diffusion to move things. Active transport is going to use ATP. So you're going to be able to put something where it doesn't necessarily want to be. So you're going to be able to build up a diffusion gradient, or you're going to be able to concentrate something. Bulk flow is when water passes through a membrane. For the most part, it's water, but it could be other things. So the way I break down transport, the first thing is there's passive, which is no energy. And then there's active, which requires energy. The passive can be simple. So something can just passively diffuse through the cell membrane. Small lipids, water molecules, things like that. We talked about how glucose is in your gut and it needs to diffuse out of your gut and into cells, but it needs a tunnel. So that's facilitated diffusion. Jumping over here to active, there's two different ways you can divide up active. The direction of flow. So are the things transported in one direction? That's called symport. Or are the things transported in the opposite direction? That's called antiport. So S1 is going one way, S2 is going the other way. A good example of that is sometimes sodium will go one way and glucose will go the opposite direction. We can also divide up transport or active transport by how does it use ATP. Primary transport directly uses ATP. Secondary transport may use the diffusion gradient set up by primary transport. So for example, one of the pumps in your cells pumps a lot of sodium outside the cell, and it's going to use ATP to do that. So that's primary. There are other transporters that will let some of that sodium come back in as long as it brings something else with it, like a glucose or a vitamin or an amino acid or something like that. That's called secondary. So that other transporter that's bringing in glucose isn't burning the ATP, but an ATP did have to be burned to develop the sodium gradient that allows the glucose to come in. So let's break those down just so we can be a little bit redundant. Simple diffusion, some things like small lipid-soluble molecules or water can diffuse right into a cell. So that's simple diffusion. If something needs a tunnel, then it's called facilitated. So it might be glucose or amino acids. It's just a tunnel, but everything is still going down a diffusion gradient. And here you see some of those channel proteins and some of those proteins back in our fluid mosaic model. Active transport uses ATP. One of the biggest ones we're going to talk about, something called the sodium-potassium pump or sodium-potassium ATPase. It's going to use ATP to pump sodium out of the cell and potassium into the cell. So we divide up active transport by direction. So symport means everything is going the same direction. Antiport means things are going the opposite direction. So like I said, if you're going to pump sodium out and potassium in, that would be an antiporter transport. Just kind of another view. So we can have sodium calcium antiporters, hydrogen ion or acid sodium antiporters, or you can have symporters. So again, sodium is coming in and glucose is coming in. Those are symporters moving in the same direction. We can also divide it into primary and secondary. Again, primary, you're going to burn an ATP directly. Often when you burn that ATP, you're setting up a concentration gradient. The main one that cells do is they pump sodium to the outside and potassium to the inside. Now that sodium wants to get back in. So the way secondary active transport works is it will allow sodium to diffuse down its concentration gradient back into the cell, as long as it takes something else with it, or as long as it pushes something else out of the cell. So it may allow sodium to come in as long as it takes a glucose. Or it might be like a revolving door kind of transporter where sodium goes in as long as the calcium leaves so that the cell can get rid of calcium. So secondary active transport is using ATP secondarily. ATP had to be used to create the sodium gradient, and then that sodium gradient is used to exchange things across the cell membrane. The last thing is bulk transport, which is usually used for water. Endocytosis is when you grab something from outside the cell and you pull it in. So endocytosis is moving in, and then you might transport it across cells and push it out the other side. That's called exocytosis. Or maybe you want to get rid of waste products from inside the cell and you want to push them out of the cell. That's also exocytosis. So let's make a nice note card of the different types of transport. So we have passive, no ATP. Active, which is ATP, and then we have bulk. Let's do the simple one first. Bulk was broken down into endocytosis, which is you're going to pull something into the cell. Exocytosis is you're going to push a vesicle out. Passive transport, there were two different types. Simple is going to go straight through the membrane. That would be water and small lipids. facilitated, you're going to make a tunnel. So there's going to be a protein tunnel that lets glucose through or amino acids through. Kind of a big diagram here, but it shows both primary and secondary, and it shows both antiporters and symporters. You're going to be seeing this one a lot. So this is a primary active antiporter. It's called the sodium potassium ATPase. It's going to pump three sodiums out and two potassiums in. So since it's using an ATP, it's primary. Since those things are going in opposite direction, it's an antiporter. Once you pump all this sodium out, there's other transporters that will use that sodium in a secondary way. So maybe you'll let sodium come back in down its concentration gradient as long as it brings in glucose. So this would be secondary active because there's no ATP burned here. And it would also be a symporter since sodium and glucose are going in the same direction. Passive transport requires none of the above. So small lipid molecules can go straight through the membrane. What must be present for diffusion to occur? You need a concentration gradient. You don't really always need a protein carrier, although that will be present in facilitated diffusion. Which of the following is not an example of passive transport? I'd say the best example there, it's not really a fair question, but pinocytosis. So when you grab little vesicles of water and move them across the cell. When movement of sodium ions down their concentration gradient drives the transport of other substances across the cell membrane, it's called secondary active transport, so B. Which of the following is not necessary for active transport? You do need a carrier, so you need that sodium potassium pump or ATPase. You do need energy, probably need a cell membrane. You don't need a concentration gradient. You can pump against a concentration gradient and put sodium to the outside of the cell or put potassium against the concentration gradient towards the inside of the cell. Active transport is similar to facilitated diffusion in all of the following except it is specific. It does exhibit saturation. It is reversible. It doesn't move with the gradient. Active transport moves against the gradient. You're going to use ATP to do it, but you're going to put something where it doesn't necessarily want to be by diffusion alone. So vesicular transport, we won't really cover too much. And then that's control of exit and entry. Maintaining a voltage, just like the sodium potassium ATPase, we talked about how that's going to be important. It's going to be really important when we get to neurons and when we get to the heart. So the plasma membrane, like we said, it's going to pump sodium to the outside. So if you look at this figure, sodium is the little blue ones. And there's more sodium on the outside than there is on the inside. There's also more potassium on the inside than there is on the outside. And that's all due to something called the sodium potassium ATPase. This animation isn't really going to work, but essentially what it is this pump is going to take two potassium and put it on the inside of the cell. So this is the inside of the cell. And three sodium and put it out. So the sodium potassium ATPase always takes three sodiums, puts it to the outside of the cell, takes two potassiums and puts it on the inside of the cell. So what's happening here is the membrane protein is grabbing three sodium from the inside of the cell. So this is the inside of the cell or cytoplasm. This is the extracellular space, so outside of the cell. It's going to grab three sodium. It's going to split the ATP and sodium is pushed out. Now potassium is going to load. The ATP now is going to drop off a phosphate, drop off the ADP, and the potassium will then enter the cell. I don't think you really need to know about the ATP split, but the main thing you need to know is three sodium are loaded from the inside. ATP is used to push the sodium out. Two potassium are grabbed from the outside and pushed to the inside. Over here, you see the concentration gradient where the sodium concentration gradient is high outside, so there's more sodium outside. There's going to be more potassium inside. So I like to simplify this a little bit, but it is a simplification. Is if you're going to take three sodium and push it out and two potassium and push them in, you're pushing out three positive charges and only taking in two positive charges. So that means you're pushing positives to the outside of the cell. Now, the first person could have said the outside of the cell is positive, or they could have said the inside of the cell is negative. It's the same thing. But we generally speak about the inside of the cell is negative. Now, if you want to know technically what happens is we pump sodium to the outside, potassium to the inside, and potassium leaks out of the cell. And when potassium leaks out of the cell, it takes its positive charge with it. It's able to leak out faster than sodium is able to leak in. So there's more positives leaking out than positives leaking in. So since more positives are leaving, the inside of the cell becomes negative. We usually speak about this as the inside of the cell has a voltage of around minus 70 millivolts. So that maintains a voltage. Cell-to-cell communication. Cells need to talk to each other. So these down here are neurons. Neurons need to talk to each other, but other cells need to talk to each other too. The main ways that cells talk to each other is contact signaling. So this one is important in cancer. So cells need to be able to say, hey, I don't have enough room to divide. You're touching me, so don't divide. Other cells, like this is a macrophage, can touch bacteria and know that it's something it should attack. Electrical signaling is a way for one cell to talk to another one. You can release chemicals. Or also, you can bind things to the outside of the cell to something called G-linked receptors. This will come up in endocrine. The cool thing about G-protein-linked receptors is one signal on the outside will cause 10 molecules to change on the inside. And then those 10 molecules will change 10 other molecules. And then those 100 molecules will change 10 other molecules. And so you get this rapid cascade where you amplify a single signal on the outside, but get lots of signals on the inside. So membrane receptors, contact signaling, so cells know when they're touching each other. Electrical signal, voltage goes down a cell, and that is used in neurons, for example. When you want to wiggle your toe, that's going to go from your brain down to your toe, and it's going to happen pretty fast. So you use electrical signaling to do that. Chemical signaling is maybe you release a chemical from a neuron, and it binds to a receptor. Or G-proteins, again, are a way to bind one molecule on the outside and amplify that multiple times on the inside of the cell. And again, that'll come up in endocrine. So we'll talk about G-proteins when we get to the endocrine system. The main thing to know at this point is it amplifies a singular signal on the outside into multiple signals on the inside. So maybe you want one signal on the outside to cause a lot of changes inside the cell. You would use G-proteins. All right, so that's cell to cell. The last thing we got to cover for plasma membrane, woohoo, is support. The cell is supported by the cytoskeleton, so it's kind of the skeleton of the cell. And there's three main types, microtubules, microfilaments, and intermediate filaments. Kind of a cool figure from OpenStax. So this shows microtubules, microfilaments, and intermediate filaments. And you kind of get an idea of where they are. So microtubules are kind of extending into the inside of the cell and across the cell. Microfilaments kind of make up the skeleton or outside of the cell. Intermediate filaments, if you look down here, are pretty thin, usually made of keratins, and so it's kind of a small network of fibers. It would kind of be, if you're going to make a big building out of beams, the beams would be the microtubules. Smaller things would be actin, and the 2x4s, or the smallest little structure, would be the intermediate filaments. So again, microfilaments, that's kind of a cool figure, made of actin. They attach to the inside of the plasma membrane, so the cytoplasmic side of the plasma membrane, and kind of hold the cell in a particular shape. They're really important in endocytosis and exocytosis. Intermediate filaments, they're kind of stretching all over. They're kind of small. They're tough. They're insoluble. They have really strong strength as far as they don't stretch. That's what tensile strength means. And so it allows the cell to maintain its strength. If you think about it, when you're pushing on your cells, you hit yourself in the arm. You're hitting bunches of cells, and those cells are resisting that punch because of all the cytoskeletal elements. The main one that stretches throughout the cell, they're kind of small, but they stretch throughout the cell, are intermediate filaments. Microtubules are the big guys. They're kind of hollow tubes, and they're kind of also like the railroad tracks of a cell. So if a cell, thinking about a neuron, it might be a meter long or 3 feet long. It might need to move something from one end to the other. It just made something in the nucleus, and it needs to move it all those 3 feet down to the other end. You need kind of a railroad track, and that's what microtubules do. So they're hollow tubes. They determine the overall shape of the cell, form the basic structure of things like cilia and flagella, and again are the tracks for moving things around. They extend from something called centrioles, and these are kind of like barrel-shaped structures near the nucleus. You can see one here, and what they will do is extend, especially in mitosis, extend these spindles that will allow the chromosomes to move to one side or the other. So when we looked at mitosis, we noted that the chromosomes lined up on the metaphase plate, and then in anaphase, they move to the side. They're being pulled to the side towards telophase because of the microtubules that arise from the centrioles. So this is kind of a simple figure, but it shows down here a microtubule. You have these proteins that will bind to the microtubules, grab onto cargo, and they'll walk their way down the microtubule. And it's kind of cool. You have some that just move in one direction, some that can go back and forth, and some that will just move in what's called anterograde. So if we're talking about a neuron, you have certain transport molecules that will move from the soma or the cell body or the nucleus out to the end. But you might want to recycle things that are out at the end of the neuron back towards the nucleus, so you have different transporters for that. Microtubules also give rise to cilia. Cilia are pretty important in the respiratory system, also in the reproductive system to keep things basically cleaned out. What cilia do is they move pathogens to where that can be dealt with. So that might be moving things out, or it might move the egg down the fallopian tube, or it might move things out of your lung up towards your trachea and into the esophagus so you can digest it. So cytoskeleton, you need to know microfilaments are made of actin, important in exocytosis and endocytosis, and they determine cell shape. Intermediate filaments are strong. They're kind of like the beams in a house. Microtubules are important in cilia and flagella, kind of like the railroad tracks. They're made of tubulin. They're important in mitosis, and they arise from centrioles. So that's it for plasma membrane. Plasma membrane takes up a lot of our lecture on cells. So again, that finishes up plasma membrane. All right, now that we're done with plasma membrane, we're on to the nucleus. And if we look at this list, we think, wow, there's still a long way to go. And I guess there technically is, but if we look at this slider, you realize that much of what we're talking about with cells really does come down to plasma membrane, letting things in and out. But there are some animal cell components that we still have to cover, like nucleus, ribosomes, ER, Golgi body vesicles, mitochondria, and cytoskeleton. So this is just a generalized cell. We talked about this at the beginning, that it's just a prototypical cell. It's kind of the basic cell. But cells come in multiple different styles and shapes. The main thing with the nucleus is this is the gene controlling center. So this is where your DNA is. Remember that DNA is really just the way that we make protein. It's the instructions for making protein. But since we're made of a lot of protein, the DNA is basically the control center of the cell and of the body. It contains a nuclear envelope, which is essentially kind of like the plasma membrane, but it's around the nucleus instead. Contains a genetic library with blueprints for nearly all cellular proteins. The only exceptions would be the mitochondria have some of their own DNA, and dictates the kinds and amounts of proteins to be synthesized. Kind of a cool close-up of it. And then make a simple note card about that. So the nuclear envelope, double phospholipid bilayer. We're going to talk about these nuclear pores in a second, but when you copy the DNA and turn it into mRNA. mRNA is going to be your way to make protein. Well, that has to get out of the nucleus through these nuclear pores. DNA is wrapped around something called histones. And then the nucleolus, we'll talk about that in a second. Really, its job is to make ribosomes. And ribosomes help make proteins. Which of the following cell types does not possess a nucleus at maturity? Kind of a trick question. Maybe you don't know this one. I think it's really cool because it's back to the principle of complementarity. That a red blood cell, you want it as small as possible so it can fit through capillaries. You don't want any extra stuff in there because all you want it to do is carry oxygen. So red blood cells will actually have a nucleus when they're developing, but they'll kick it out so that they can carry more oxygen. Nucleoli, cytoribosome production. There's some indication that some diseases might have to do with problems in the nucleoli, like Parkinson's too. So there may be a lot more going on there than what we understand. So this black kind of blob right here is the nucleolus. This would be the nuclear membrane. And then all of this is your DNA kind of unwound in what looks like a bowl of spaghetti because your DNA is unwound so that you can make copies of it or so you can make small little copies of it to make proteins. A lot of times when we think about DNA, we think about it in this way. This is called a karyotype where they're looking at different DNA structures to see if you have the right number of chromosomes. I don't know that you need to get all of this detail, but you should probably basically know the DNA is a double helix. It kind of starts to wrap itself up, and we often see DNA or chromosomes like this when we're looking at mitosis. But essentially, you go from DNA, which is a long, long, long strand, wraps itself around histones, and it will continue to wind until it makes an actual chromosome that can be split apart in cell division or mitosis. So this is actually a picture of a red blood cell ejecting its nucleus. And you can see why it does that is because it leaves all of this other part basically to carry oxygen, to have hemoglobin to carry oxygen, and get rid of this nucleus. You can also see the chromatin in this nucleus. All right, so that's nucleus. Endomembrane system is kind of complex. It's a lot of different things. So it's ribosomes, ER, Golgi, vesicles. I don't know if I would have included mitochondria there. I'd call mitochondria more of an organelle, which is what I guess I'm trying to lead to here, which is the rest of the cell outside of the nucleus can be divided into two major systems, the endomembrane system, which makes proteins, and then there's other organelles like mitochondria and lysosomes and peroxisomes and things like that. What's an endomembrane system? So it's basically the system for making proteins or also processing fats in the case of smoothie are. So let's look at the parts. So you've got the nucleus. The DNA is in the nucleus, but you need to make copies of it in the form of mRNA, and that needs to make it out into the cytosol. So you need nuclear pores, holes in the nuclear membrane. You need rough ER. Rough ER makes proteins. It's not the only place you make proteins. Ribosomes technically make proteins, and they can be free out here as well. I'm trying to show proteins being transported here to something called the Golgi apparatus. The Golgi apparatus does things like quality control and shipping. Another thing on here should be smooth ER. Smooth ER basically, I think maybe it's four, smooth ER processes fats. And since fats play a role in hormones, smooth ER can be considered to be a hormone production location. So essentially the endomembrane system of organelles that help you make biological things, so make proteins and make fats. They also get rid of stuff when you need to get rid of things. So another look, just using the figure from OpenStax, what we're going to look at is the nuclear envelope. So inside here is the nucleolus where you make ribosomes. Here's the DNA. You need to make copies of that DNA and let it out of the nucleus through the nuclear envelope. These little red dots are ribosomes. So this is rough ER. These ribosomes can exist other places. Ribosomes help make proteins. Most of your proteins need to be made on a membrane. So they either need to get out of the cell using a membrane, or it's like a membrane channel or a membrane protein. All of those proteins are made in rough ER. There's a few proteins that aren't actually going to leave the cell, are just going to be used by the cell, and they can be made on ribosomes that are free-floating. You also have smooth ER, that processes fats and it detoxifies in liver cells. Lysosomes, we'll talk about, are kind of the trash can of the cell. Vacuoles are a way that you ship. Transport vesicles, kind of the same thing. Vacuoles might hold water and things like that sometimes. Golgi apparatus, down here is the shipping department, and then of course you have the plasma membrane. So the nuclear envelope we've kind of already talked about, but nothing like a little bit of redundancy to really kind of get it in. So let's say it again. Nuclear envelope is kind of like how the plasma membrane is the membrane that surrounds a cell. The nuclear envelope surrounds the nucleus. It's technically a double membrane, and it's continuous with the ER. There's a nucleoplasm that's inside, and the idea here is to keep your DNA well protected, so it has a separate kind of solution around the DNA, and there's an extra wall that protects your DNA, protects anything from getting inside the cell and damaging your DNA. Ribosomes, we talked about ribosomes technically make proteins. Free ribosomes, they might synthesize proteins that are just kind of floating around in the cytosol and proteins that are going to stay in the cell. But any protein that needs to leave or is normally in a membrane, like an ion channel, has to be made in a membrane. So it has to be made in membrane-bound ribosomes, which are the rough ER. The rough ER and the smooth ER. First of all, ER generally is just these tubes. And then the thing that differentiates rough and smooth are the presence of ribosomes. So these little black dots are ribosomes, so this would be rough ER. You don't really see those ribosomes here, and so this is smooth ER. So just a little bit closer view. Again, we mentioned ribosomes make proteins, so if ribosomes are on ER, then rough ER helps you to make proteins. Specifically proteins that have to be exported, or proteins that normally exist in a membrane. Couldn't find the best figure here, but it's kind of nice to understand this because you can get diseases when this goes wrong. Is there are free ribosomes out here, and that can just basically synthesize protein on their own. But again, most proteins have to be synthesized on rough ER because they're either going to be exported in a vesicle, or that protein normally exists in a plasma membrane or in a membrane. So messenger RNA that's going to be in a membrane or it's going to be exported takes the RNA to the rough ER. The signal that does this is called a signal recognition particle. It's kind of difficult to see this in this figure, but what's going to happen is when the mRNA docks with the ribosome, you'll start to make the protein and sort of inject it into the rough ER. So the protein is released into the cisterna, or the inside of the rough ER. An important signaling thing happens here, though, is you add certain sugars to help this protein fold in the right shape and to kind of put an address on it or a label on it where this protein needs to go. The protein then is shipped off from the rough ER to the Golgi apparatus. We'll talk about the Golgi in a second, but Golgi quality control. So it makes sure that a protein is folded correctly. It'll finish folding that protein, and it will also package those proteins into vesicles to be excreted from the cell. So that's rough ER. Smooth ER looks a lot like rough ER, but no ribosomes, so it's not going to make proteins. What smooth ER does is it mainly processes fats. So rough ER processes proteins, smooth ER processes fats. In some places, it's really specialized. So in the liver, it's specialized to process things like cholesterol. In the testes, you make hormones. So steroid-based hormones like testosterone are lipid-based. And so here again, the smooth ER is dealing with lipids. In the intestinal cells, here's where you absorb, synthesize, and transport fats. And a special thing about smooth ER in skeletal and cardiac muscle is it stores the calcium that is used to signal contraction. So the simple thing to know about smooth ER, it's mainly responsible for fat and lipid metabolism. In muscle, SER is the storage place for the calcium that's going to lead to muscle contraction. And in liver, smooth ER is responsible for detoxifying drugs and also processing lipids. So that's smooth ER. Golgi apparatus, kind of mentioned already, it exists outside the rough ER, kind of does packaging, or it could be called the traffic director. So it functions in modification, concentration, and packaging of proteins. So the ER does the first step of making proteins, the Golgi finishes it off. One of the things it does is it will put sugars on the proteins, a process called glycosylation, and that will help a protein be marked so that it knows where to go in the cell, or if it's being exported, where it should go. The other really important thing about the Golgi is it does quality control. Having studied cystic fibrosis, this one is kind of near and dear to my heart because one of the most major mutations that lead to cystic fibrosis is called delta F508. We're at the 508th position. You don't have a F or a phenylalanine. And the real problem with delta F508 is the Golgi apparatus erroneously believes that the protein doesn't work, and so it sends it off to the lysosome. But if the Golgi could be tricked into letting the protein go out to the cell membrane where it's supposed to, then we wouldn't have cystic fibrosis with that mutation. So just a quick review, rough ER, export proteins that are going to be membrane bound. Smooth ER does fats, detoxification in the liver, and stores calcium and muscle contraction. Golgi modifies protein, glycosylates it, concentrates it, does quality control, adds sugar so that the protein can kind of be marked. So make a nice note card that shows all those. So you've got ER with ribosomes, that's rough ER. And then here's the steps where if that protein is going to be made in a membrane, it's got something called a signal recognition particle. It's going to go to the rough ER, and the mRNA is going to be converted into protein as the protein is moved into the ER. The ER is going to add sugar tags, the protein's going to fold, and it's going to ship it over to the Golgi. The Golgi is going to do modification, concentration, packaging, and quality control. We're a little bit ahead of ourselves, but with quality control, if it's a good protein, it'll get shipped out to where it needs to go. If it's a bad protein, it'll be moved over to the lysosome. And lysosomes basically will degrade viruses and bacteria, but also degrade worn out or improperly made proteins. That leaves us with our ER that has no ribosomes. So this is not going to be protein, but smooth ER in all cells, smooth ER takes care of lipids and fats. In liver, it deals with toxicity. And in muscle, like cardiac muscle and skeletal muscle, it's your calcium storage, and calcium is used for muscle contraction. So this note card has basically everything for ER, Golgi, and it also adds lysosomes. Let's go on to cytoplasmic organelles. So these are a little bit more specialized, but like mitochondria, peroxisomes, and lysosomes are the main ones. You're kind of getting this idea that, gosh, how can we compartmentalize these because I see these in different things. I don't think you need to really know endomembrane system versus organelles, because there is some overlap, and you're kind of probably seeing that overlap. Just know what each of these things do on their own. So lysosomes are little guys, little vesicles, and what they do is they're kind of the trash can of the cell. So let's go down to that. Lysosomes, spherical, they have a really kind of a low pH. Like your stomach uses acid to break down proteins, lysosomes use acid to break down things like bacteria, viruses, toxins, or any protein that isn't made correctly or is worn out. Peroxisomes, not really well understood. They're known to use a lot of oxygen, so they're thought to break down dangerous chemicals or toxic chemicals by redox reactions. Then mitochondria. Most people know that mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell, is what it's always called. It makes ATP. It's interesting that mitochondria are thought to be derived from bacteria that invaded cells, and so they do have their own DNA. It's really kind of interesting that you get your mitochondrial DNA strictly from your mother. So it's often called Eve DNA, as in Adam and Eve, because this will be passed down from mother to mother to mother to mother. And you can actually track this back to figure out where the first female that gave rise to a lot of us was. Cellular respiration is what happens in mitochondria. So you're going to take in glucose, and you're going to use that glucose inside. This is the mitochondria right here, to go through something called the Krebs cycle. This is where you make ATP. You'd expect that cells that expend a great deal of energy, such as skeletal muscle cells, to have increased quantities of mitochondria. So mitochondria takes glucose plus oxygen, makes ATP. This should say CO2 plus CO2. So it makes ATP, and that's cellular energy. Intensely biosynthetic secretory cells, such as neurons, would be expected to have a greater amount of probably rough ER. They're going to make lots of proteins. In fact, the rough ER are so prominent in neurons that they're called another name. They're called Nissl bodies. Cytoplasm, just to finish this out, this is kind of the jello-like material that exists within the cell. And then cytosol is the water that's within the cytoplasm. So that's cytoplasmic organelles. Gotta go to cell cycle next. Cell cycle usually refers to mitosis, but in general, it's just cell division. So this is kind of a cool GIF that shows mitosis, just to orient you. So right now, DNA is winding up so that it can divide. So we kind of talked about how DNA is like a spaghetti, and then it winds up into chromosomes. So it's wound up into chromosomes. Those are going to line up along something called a metaphase plate, and then they'll divide. So they're getting lined up. It's kind of cool. Once they line up, they divide kind of quickly. And the main point, just as an introduction, is you're going to see two cells here now. So we've taken one cell, we've divided into two cells. Now there's really two different reasons you divide into two different cells. One is mitosis, or sometimes this is called somatic cell division. And it's called somatic because somatic means body. You're going to take a cell, divide it into two cells just because you need another cell. So you destroyed a liver cell, you destroyed another cell, or you're growing. You need another cell exactly like the original cell. So you need two daughter cells. That's a little bit different than meiosis. Meiosis is when you're making sex cells, so like egg and sperm. And in that case, you kind of want to mix up the DNA so the offspring are different than the parent. That's completely different, and we'll talk about that when we do reproduction. So right now, we're just doing mitosis. Two definitions first. Technically, mitosis, although we often refer to cell division as mitosis, technically mitosis is division of the nucleus. And then cytokinesis, cyto means cell, kinesis means knife or cut. That's going to be division of the cytoplasm, and that'll make sense in a second. So just touch on meiosis really quick again. So meiosis is the second type of cell division. Again, that's in sex cell production, where you want to make a different cell. You don't want to make identical twin cells. Mitosis, kind of a cool figure from Wikipedia and OpenStax. There's multiple phases going on here. So here's the starting phase, which is called G1. So this is when a cell is just divided, and it's going to start growing. It then moves to something called S phase, which this is when a cell is going to divide. It needs to start replicating its DNA. And before it divides, it might grow a little bit bigger in anticipation of cell division. So all of this over here is called interphase. It includes when a cell is preparing to divide, finishing dividing, or when a cell is just being a cell. So that's interphase. We're then going to move into the mitotic phase, and this is where we're actually going to go through mitosis and cytokinesis and become two cells. This is divided into several phases called prometaphase, prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. So interphase again is these G1s, G2, and S. I don't know that you need to know the specific details, just that S is when DNA replicates in anticipation of division. Or you might also know an interphase, that's just when a cell is being a normal cell and doing a normal cell. The other phases of mitosis are prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. Some people remember this as IPMAT, or if you're in an anatomy class, it's easier to remember it as I passed my anatomy test. So the thing to note when you're trying to figure out what phase you're in is I always note the centromeres. The centromeres are in different places based on the phase of mitosis you're in. So they're kind of all divided around the cell in prophase. They're lined up, so here they're kind of all over the place. So that's prophase and prometaphase. They'll line up in metaphase. They'll kind of be between the middle of the dividing cell and the poles of the dividing cell in anaphase. And once they've reached all the way, so once these centromeres have reached all the way to the side, that's when you're in telophase. Here's all of them kind of in one chart. So again, we have prophase. Sometimes people call this early and late prophase, which I'm used to. Metaphase, anaphase, telophase. I don't know that you need to really know the difference between prophase and prometaphase. So early prophase, the DNA has been replicated already. It's still looking kind of like spaghetti because it still hasn't wound back up. But you can kind of start to see the DNA wind up. So this is late prophase. The DNA is winding up so that it can divide in different directions in metaphase. So here the DNA is kind of all wound up and it's lined up in a line. This line is called the metaphase plates. And you'll see in the next figure that half of these are going to go one way and half will go the other way in anaphase. So they kind of got to line up first so they know this one's going to go this way and this one's going to go this way. So when you see them all lined up, that's metaphase. When you see them start to pull apart, that's called anaphase. And you can kind of see that the centromeres have started to pull off to the sides. Another view of anaphase. So we're starting to see cytokinesis here because a cell or the cytoplasm is starting to divide. And also those centromeres have reached all the way to the external pole of the cells. And so now we're in telophase. Cytokinesis is you're going to finish off the division of the cytosol in what's called a cleavage furrow. So you're seeing here that clearly you're getting two cells, and then you're going to enter interphase as these cells start to grow again. So again, nice note card. Here's a cell in interphase, starts to wind up his DNA in early and late prophase. Those chromosomes line up in metaphase. This is called the metaphase plates. As the chromosomes move apart, we're in anaphase. We can see that the centromeres are somewhere along the midline between the equator and the pole. We're starting to get cytokinesis, which is the cytosol is splitting. And we've moved our centromeres all the way to the pole, so we're in telophase. When we finish this cytokinesis, we're going to have two different cells. The way to remember these phases is I passed my anatomy test for interphase, prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. An interesting thing about mitosis is it plays a central role in cancer. So these things called cyclins that prevent cell division, or at least will hold it up when a cell knows it shouldn't divide. So cells should not divide if they're already touching other cells because there's not enough room to divide. A cell has a protein called P53 that's supposed to signal a cell not to divide if there's damage to the DNA. Also, if a cell is not mature enough, it shouldn't divide. So cyclins work basically on the principle of stop replicating if you're not a healthy cell. Sometimes it's pictured in cycles like this. So M stands for mitosis, G1, S, and G2. And several places along the cycle, there are stopping points to basically tell the cell you should not be going through mitosis because there's something wrong with you. This is a figure from a pharmaceutical company, and I think I can explain basically what's going on. Is down here is DNA, and we're going to replicate that DNA in order to go through mitosis. So we have a cell in G1 phase. Remember, going to S phase means we're going to duplicate that DNA so we can go through mitosis.
clearly don't need to remember all these factors, but there's a lot of factors that can come down here and halt this process. Probably the main one that you might have heard about is P53. So if there's damage to DNA, P53 is supposed to come down here and not allow the cell to go from G1 phase to S phase. Other ones that are interesting is growth factor withdrawal. So when you stop growing, you should slow down your cell division. Contact inhibition is here too. So if a cell is already next to another cell, that cell should inhibit going from G1 phase to S phase. So clearly you don't need to memorize all this, but it's kind of nice to get the idea that these are all called cyclins, and cyclins will stop a cell from dividing. Any problem with cyclin, though, can lead to cancer. So again, one of the major forms of cancer, or one of the major predictors of cancer, is damage to P53. People that do not have a quality P53 or mutations in P53 are much more prone to cancer, especially skin cancer. The reason skin cancer is because skin cells are prone to DNA damage from UV radiation. So don't need to know the details, just need to know that these cyclins play a huge role in cancer, and most of the drugs that are given to treat cancer these days have to do with cyclin. Although there was an interesting study that just came out this week. When they give cells antibiotics against mitochondria, that seemed to slow cancer too. So mitosis is the division of the technically the nucleus. It would be the nucleus. Cytokinesis is defined as the division of the cytoplasm. I don't know why I duplicated that. Which would not be an outcome of mitosis in the human body? Reproduction is the answer there, because that's when you go through meiosis. Next up for us is something called the central dogma. The central dogma is known as the path of information flow in biological organisms. So you have to have DNA replicated when you reproduce a cell or when you make another cell. DNA has to be converted into something called RNA in order to make protein. Another way to show this is DNA hangs out in the nucleus of the cell. I mentioned this metaphor before, but when you're going to build a new building and you've got architectural plans, you don't take that original set of plans out to the build site. You make a copy of that. So DNA is kind of our original plans for how to make a protein, and that stays in the cell. Sometimes we need to duplicate it because we want to make a whole other cell. Sometimes we just want to make a copy of that DNA and move it out into the cytosol where we're going to make the protein. Or in the metaphor, it's where you make a copy of the architectural plans and take those out to the build site to actually build something. So DNA has to be replicated. DNA has to be converted into RNA. And RNA is converted into protein. That first part of the central dogma is DNA replication when you want to make a new cell. So DNA replication, you're just going to replicate the DNA to serve as another blueprint for a brand new daughter cell. Kind of see in this figure that this is one long DNA molecule, and it's coming apart in certain places to make a duplicate. A couple of things you need to know before you can understand DNA replication is to go through the structure. And remember that DNA is a double helix, so it kind of looks like a spiral staircase. And there's four different base pairs that form the rungs or the stairs of this ladder or these stairs. So there's adenine and thymine, and if you look closely, adenine and thymine are always base paired. So A is always base paired to T, and C is always base paired to G. The reason that is technically is because thymine and cytosine are single rings, whereas adenine and guanine are double ring. So you're always going to have a double ring and a single ring nucleotide so that the size of the rung of the ladder or the stair is always the same. You couldn't have two adenines. You couldn't have two adenines together or an adenine and a guanine together, because then those would be too big of molecules. Another kind of technicality that's important is DNA is talked about as being 3' and 5'. Where that comes from is if you look at the actual sugar phosphate backbone. It's been a long time since I've had organic chemistry, but I remember you number the carbons based on their proximity to something that's not a carbon. So this is the first carbon, second carbon, third carbon, fourth carbon, and five carbon. When you're going to add another one, so like up here you've got two different sugar phosphates together. If we're going to add another one here, you can only add to the 3' carbon. So if you're going to add another base, it has to be to the 3'. So if we're going to extend these in a long chain, we can only add to the 3' end. We'll come back to that in a second, but it means that since you can only add in one direction, when you're splitting the DNA, one of the strands has to go this way. But it means one of the strands has to go this way. So what's happening here is we've got a chromosome and it's unwinding. DNA polymerase is the enzyme that will track along the DNA. So here's the old strand of DNA. And as we track along, it's going to base pair. So here we've got a C. I don't remember which color. So this is a C, and it's going to add a guanine. Then it's going to see an A here, and it's going to add a thymine. So it's just going to ride along the DNA as the DNA unwinds. The problem is this DNA polymerase cannot go in that same direction because it would have to be going the opposite direction on 3' to 5'. So we can only add to the 3' end. So we could add here, or we could add here, but we can't add to the 5' end. What actually has to happen, and there's a figure that's coming up, is this will go a little bit of the way, and it'll have to pop off. Then as the DNA unwinds, it'll jump back and get back on the DNA and basically start copying. So it kind of has to leapfrog backwards as the DNA unwinds. The specific enzyme that unwinds DNA is called helicase. So again, you have two different strands here then. You have what's called a continuous strand or a leading strand, where basically the DNA polymerase rides along the DNA and base pairs as the DNA unwinds. DNA polymerase here, it can't go this direction. This is called the lagging strand. It has to go from here to here. Then as the DNA unwinds, it has to jump back, do another short fragment. As the DNA unwinds, it has to jump back, do another small fragment. It's not that the reason this works this way is you only have one DNA polymerase, a 5' to 3' DNA polymerase. So you only have one. Make that one perfect as you can and use that so you don't get mutations, rather than having one DNA polymerase that's 5' to 3' and another DNA polymerase that's 3' to 5'. So again, one strand proceeds easily from 5' to 3', the other has to jump in what are called Okazaki fragments. And again, that comes down to you can only add to the OH here on the 3 carbon. We can't add another base pair to the 5' end. So this figure is kind of a little bit of a close-up, but now they switch things. So here's the leading strand. The DNA is here. It's unwinding. The leading strand DNA polymerase just rides along the DNA. As the DNA unwinds, it adds bases. Up here, the DNA polymerase on the lagging strand has to go this direction. So it will jump on the DNA, go 5' to 3', and fill in a little hunk. Then as the DNA unwinds, it'll jump back here, ride along 5' to 3', and fill in another little hunk. There's a molecule called ligase that will then come back and join those little fragments together. The individual fragments are called Okazaki fragments after the discoverer. So that's DNA replication. That's probably the easy parts. Now we got to do protein synthesis. So again, DNA, it's really just a blueprint for how to make proteins. Genes are segments of DNA carrying the information for that protein. Those can be broken down into triplets, and you'll see why. It's essentially three base pairs coordinate to indicate what amino acid should be added to the polypeptide next. Again, this is kind of another figure that shows the central dogma, where when you have DNA in the nucleus, it might be used for replication, might be used to make protein. If it's being used to make protein, then there's two steps. We're going to copy that DNA into an RNA that's going to leave the nucleus. That's called transcription, or we're going to transcribe the DNA. Once that transcribed DNA is out here, it's called an mRNA, and we have to translate that into a protein, so that's called protein translation. So essentially copying the DNA, the master blueprint that's going to stay in the nucleus, to take the protein out to the job site is called transcription. Once we have that copy out to the job site, we're going to turn it into a protein in what's called translation. So transcription occurs in the nucleus. We make an mRNA, take the mRNA out into the cytosol, where we translate it into a protein. Transcription is pretty easy because we've got a DNA molecule. We're just going to split that DNA molecule in half, and we're going to make a copy. When we make a copy, remember, we don't have T's in RNA. We have uracils instead. So notice if we have an A here, we add a U. If we had a T in the DNA, we're going to add an A. So we're simply going to copy a little bit of that DNA and turn it into an RNA transcript, which is called messenger RNA or mRNA. So that's pretty simple, pretty straightforward. Technically, we have something called RNA polymerase that unwinds the DNA templates. We go through the DNA and just copy, base pair it. A's to U's and C's to G's. That's transcription. So translation is a little bit more technical, as we can see from this figure, but let's parse this out a little bit first. First, color coding. The messenger RNA, so that copy of the DNA that left the nucleus, is called messenger RNA, and it's in hot pink here. We got something called transfer, or tRNAs. tRNAs bring in the amino acids. So remember, the messenger RNA tells us the code that we need for what amino acids come next. I consider tRNAs kind of the fetcher. They bring in the amino acids. We also have ribosomes. We talked about ribosomes before because they make proteins. They can also be referred to as ribosomal RNA. All right, so those are the major parts. But let's talk about how it works. Not nearly as pretty of a figure, but I think we can make it work. So this beige kind of structure is the ribosome, or the rRNA. This kind of orange structure is the messenger RNA. And remember, that's a sequence of base pairs. So an AUG that's been copied from the DNA. The other thing we had is the tRNA. tRNA is going to base pair also to the mRNA, but it's going to bring along with it an amino acid. The first thing to note is the first three bases, or codon, is always going to be AUG. It's called a start codon. And it's always going to code for methionine. That's pretty important because it means you need methionine in order to make all your proteins. So if you happen to be short on methionine, then you're going to be short on making proteins. Interestingly, you need B12 to make methionine. What would you think is probably the most important protein in your body? Probably one of the most important is hemoglobin. So if you're low in B12, vitamin B12, you're low in methionine, you won't be able to make as much hemoglobin, and you'll get pernicious anemia. So that's why some of this needs to be known, or should be known. So you need B12 in order to maximize protein production. Okay, so we got our start codon, we got our messenger RNA. Essentially what happens is there's a specific code here. So we talked about how when you're matching DNA, A goes to T and C goes to G. And when you're matching DNA to RNA, it's going to be A goes to U, C goes to G. The same thing happens, the same matching occurs between the tRNA. So if you have an AUG, our start codon, with its methionine is going to base pair with UAC. Maybe our next codon is a UUU. Well, the only tRNA that's going to bind to that is an AAA, which happens to have a different amino acid, in this case, phenylalanine. So we now have added a methionine and a phenylalanine. So now we're going to bring in another tRNA, and it's going to code to the next three-letter code. In this case, it's going to bring in arginine. So simply by matching base pairs to tRNA, and those tRNA have specific amino acids, we're going to start adding amino acids together, following the code of the mRNA. So additional amino acids are simply added as the ribosome moves along the mRNA, makes sure that the tRNA matches up, and then attaches those amino acids together to start making a polypeptide. This is kind of a nice review figure because it shows up here how we base paired DNA. So if the original template had a T, the other side of the DNA is going to have an A. If one side of the DNA has an A, the other side has a T. When we copy this to make mRNA, we're going to have a kind of the same exact sequence as the other side of the DNA, except we're going to have U's. So notice here we have an ATGC. Down here we have an AUGC. So we've base paired, but we switched the T's for the U. So this is the mRNA. mRNA, the first codon is always AUG, and it codes for a tRNA that has a methionine. This would be a proline that must have a GGC anticodon or a matching RNA. Next, we have a CAA. This would be a glycine. The glycine tRNA would have a GUU. So it's a simple process of base pairing. One of the tricky things about the genetic code is I need to code for 20 amino acids. So what that means is I need more than one letter. So if I had a one-letter code, if I had a C, I had one amino acid, I had a U, I had another amino acid, I could only code for four different amino acids. Similarly, if I just used a two-letter code, so if I just said a UC means phenylalanine and a UA means a tyrosine, well, then I could only code for 16 amino acids because I'd have a four different things in the first position, four different things in the second position, 4 times 4 is 16. So I'd only have a 16 codes, 16 different codes, but I need to code for 20 amino acids. So the reason we have a three-letter code or a codon is because you need at least three letters to code for 20 different amino acids. Technically, you can code for 4 times 4 times 4 amino acids, so 64, but we only need to code for 20. What that means is sometimes the same three-letter code will code for the same amino acid. So a UCU, a UCC, a UCA, or a UCG will all code for the amino acid serine. What this means is it's called a degenerate code. There's not a one-to-one code. Sometimes more than four codons will code for the same amino acid. It's also pretty cool that this is pretty universal. Almost every organism on Earth, there's like only a couple of exceptions, don't use this exact same code when they code between a codon and a specific amino acid. On here was the start codon, which is always methionine. There are some stop codons here too. So if the mRNA and the tRNA and the ribosome come along and they find a UAA in the mRNA or a UGA in the mRNA or a UAG in the mRNA, that's the code to say, hey, we're at the end of this protein, we're done, so stop. And the ribosome will drop off, the tRNAs will drop off, and the polypeptide will be made. So another kind of little note card, the main thing up here is DNA, it should have said DNA up here. It's going to replicate with DNA polymerase. Or we're going to copy that DNA using RNA polymerase to make a messenger RNA. All of this occurs in the nucleus of the cell. This mRNA will exit through the nuclear pore and be turned into a protein. So the first step where we copy the DNA into the mRNA is called transcription. Copying the mRNA into a protein is called translation. DNA replication is pretty easy. We've got the DNA polymerase going along the leading strand, and as the DNA unwinds, it will just base pair. We talked about how DNA polymerase only goes 5 prime to 3 prime, so on the opposite end, the lagging strand, we have to jump on here and go a little distance, and then the DNA polymerase will fall off. As the DNA unwinds, it'll open into the fork, jump on, and replicate a little bit in what are called Okazaki fragments. Those Okazaki fragments will be ligated together or glued together with ligase. Transcription was pretty easy. You just pull apart the DNA a little bit. RNA polymerase will ride along the DNA and make an mRNA copy. Once you have an mRNA copy, you can start making this into protein out in the cytosol. You'll need two other types of RNA, tRNA or transfer RNA, and ribosomal RNA, which is kind of depicted by this big kind of circle. What happens is we start with an AUG that's going to base pair with a tRNA that has UAC, and this first amino acid is always going to be methionine. The ribosome will move along the RNA, and tRNAs will bind by base pairing. Each of those tRNAs is going to code for a different amino acid. Those amino acids will be joined together into a long polypeptide. So essentially the DNA code gives us the mRNA code. Remember this kind of coding? Well, when we're base pairing DNA, if we had an ATCG, the opposite side of DNA is going to be TAG. If we're going to code this strand of DNA for mRNA, it's going to be very similar to one strand of DNA, except there won't be T's, there'll be U's. The mRNA is going to be base paired to tRNAs, kind of the same way. If there's an A and the mRNA, the tRNA would have a U. It's kind of interesting that these two, so one strand of the DNA and the mRNA will be exactly the same, except for T's to use. The opposite side of the DNA will be very similar to the tRNA, again, except for there won't be T's, they'll be U's. For every three nucleotides in a gene, one amino acid is coded. The major function of DNA is to dictate protein production. I would say the best answer here is translation is when the protein is actually made. Transcription is when the DNA is copied to mRNA, but when the mRNA is turned into protein, that's called translation. Proteins are synthesized at the rough ER. Now, I don't think we necessarily need to know this, but I wanted to cover it just because it extends what we're talking about into actual diseases, and those are mutation. You have two different types, environmental, so this could be pesticides or smoking or things like that, or you can get mutations simply from mistakes in replication, transcription, and translation. So you get different modified bases, so the base will make an error, and so you all of a sudden get a G linked to a T. So that should have been an AT, but now you've got a G and a T. The major types of mutation are point mutation, frameshift mutations, and deletions. The only reason I want to point this out is a small little change in mRNA or in DNA replication can lead to a pretty big change in the protein that's made because of this codon sequencing. So for example, we've got a bunch of three-letter words here. The fat cat ate the wee rats. A point mutation means we're just going to replace one base. So maybe there should have been an A, and we're going to put in a C. Since the amino acids are in codons, it's not going to really cause a huge mutation. One amino acid is going to be wrong. So for example here, one word is changed from cat to hat. So a point mutation is not a big mutation. But again, because of this codon, what if all of a sudden we delete a letter? So if we delete a letter, then all the three-letter words shift because, again, amino acids are coded in threes. So if we delete the T, every other letter slides up. And because the three-letter code codes for amino acid, each of these would be a different amino acid. So that's going to cause a pretty big shift or change in the protein structure. We can also get deletions, big deletions. This causes certain birds to be formed without feathers. But in this case, we deleted the C. So again, everybody shifts over. It's going to cause quite a bit of a change in the structure again. There's kind of a big deal between germ cells and somatic mutations. Germ mutations are sperm and egg, which means a mutation is going to get passed on generation after generation after generation. So I think it was Queen Victoria that gave rise to hemophilia. So she would have had a mutation in her germ cell line that is passed on generation after generation after generation. Somatic mutations are in the body, so it can lead to cancer, but it's not heritable. So the basic review here is DNA, you have 46 different chromosomes. There's a pair of each chromosome, so 23 pairs of chromosomes. A chromosome is a collection of genes. A gene is a collection of triplets, and those triplets code for amino acids. Amino acids are essentially a polypeptide, and polypeptides are combined to form peptides. So that's genetic mutations. I always like to throw this one in because it's interesting that this guy named Carrie Mullis discovered how to duplicate DNA in a test tube. It's called polymerase chain reaction. It's really kind of an interesting technique if you ever want to look into it. But it's kind of revolutionized the world. Carrie Mullis won the Nobel Prize because now if we get a small little amount of DNA, we can replicate it up and do genetic testing. So that's revolutionized everything from crime scene to rape detection to a bunch of other things, just being able to duplicate DNA. It's pretty cool stuff. Carrie Mullis is kind of an interesting guy. I always like to bring up Carrie Mullis because he's an interesting view of a creative scientist. So that's cells.